Happy New Year to you.
Happy New Year.
Wow, first Sunday of 2016. If you are a guest with us today, I want to particularly welcome you. Thank you for choosing to begin the new year with us on this Sunday. We'd love to find out who you are, and if there's any information that you would like. You notice when you open up the bulletin, there's a welcome card. If you could just fill out some basic information about yourself, check any boxes of where you want information from us, and then tear it off along the perforation, and a little later in the service when the offering plate comes by, just place that card into the offering plate. There are some special events coming up this month that I'd like to remind you all about. 2 weeks from today, on the 17th, we'll be having baby dedications during the morning services. Really, baby dedication here is parent dedication. What it means is the parents vowing before God and asking for our prayer that they would raise their children in a way that will honor God. That's on the 17th. And if you have a young one and are interested, notice the details in your bulletin. Then on January 24th, we're going to have baptisms in the morning services. Baptism is for those who have trusted Jesus Christ as their Savior. If you have done that but not yet been baptized, if you have put your faith in Jesus, your sins have been forgiven, you have new life from Him, you need to be baptized. Jesus commanded it. He said it's the way to make that public statement, to let people know you belong to Him. It's an obedience thing to Jesus. So on the 24th of this month, baptisms, details in your bulletin. There's a class a week before orientation to let you know what to expect. And also on the 24th, coming back to those of you who may be guests or are relatively new at Forcey in particular, we have Forcey Connects. We do that every couple months. And on the 24th of this month, a luncheon after second service we call Forcey Connects. It's to find out ways to make the connections at Forcey, find out, meet the, who the leadership, some of the leadership is, and have your questions answered, find out what Forcey is all about. So that luncheon is on January 24th, and I hope you can hope to see some of you there. We are starting today a new series that we call Marriage 101. Over the holidays, Neve and I were doing some planning. Since we're just starting 2016, this will be our 40th anniversary this June. And so, assuming we make it till June. So we were planning out our trip, but also it was an occasion just to think back on 40 years. Hard to imagine. And we were dating a while before that, too. So much of our lives. And I think about all the little segments that make up that 40 years, and it was overwhelming. But at the same time, I could not escape the feeling that it just went by in a snap. Not all marriages are like that. Ours had some really rough times, too. There are occasions when you wonder whether you're going to make it. You look at marriages that are falling apart, that are broken. They've already fallen apart. We need a series like this. We need to come back to say, what does God call us to? What can He really do? What can He really do in a marriage? I'd like you to see this video, which kind of introduces this series.
Scars and all our secrets were in the light.
On this hallowed ground we've drawn the battle line. Will we make it through the night? It's gonna take much more than promises this time. Only God can change our minds. Maybe you and I were never meant to be complete. Could we just be broken together? If you can bring your shattered dreams and I'll bring mine, can healing still be spoken and said? Broken together. How it must have been so lonely by my side. We were building kingdoms and chasing dreams and left love behind. Praying God will help our broken hearts align, and we won't give up the fight. It's gonna take much more than promises this time. Only God can change our minds. Maybe you and I were never meant to be complete. Just be broken together. If you can bring your shattered dreams and I'll bring mine, then healing still be spoken and save us. The only way will last forever. Just be broken together. If you can bring your shattered dreams and I'll bring mine, can healing still be spoken and save us? The only way will last forever is broken.
you please stand with us as we continue to worship? Sing, so I'll stand.
So I'll stand.
Church.
So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. And I'll stand my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all. I am is yours. All I am is yours, and all I am is yours.
Amen. You may be seated.
Please join with me in prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you that we can stand before you. And even though you are a great and mighty God, one who is to be feared and praised, it's such an honor that you call us friend, that you allow us to be a child of yours. Thank you for calling me and for calling many of those here to you. Lord, we thank you too that you've told us about different ways that we can worship you, that we can celebrate you, that we can honor you from our hearts and our hands and our mind, with our soul and our strength. Thank you, Lord. Lord, I just thank you for being with us at all times, whether we feel that you are near, and sometimes when we feel that you aren't near, we know that you are with us. We know that we do not need to be afraid. We thank you for the family that we have around us right now, not just the nuclear family, but our brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord, help us to continue to think of others and to take care of the needs of those around us. Help us to see those needs and then to take action. And when we don't know what to do, Lord, help us to lift those prayer requests to you and to seek your heart, and maybe even seek another brother or sister who we know does it so well to find out, okay, how can I help? And maybe it's prayer. Maybe we just need to be prayer warriors more for each other. Lord, I also just thank you that in that, you know, we just learn so much about who you are. You've given us your scriptures so that we can learn so much about you. And there's, no matter how much we know about you, there's still so much more to learn. So help us continue to desire that. And then ultimately, Lord, that knowledge and that family that we have, help us to be emboldened to go share your word, because there's so many that are lost, whether it's our family, our friends, those, our neighbors, so many around us just don't know you, Lord. And many are kind of glad that they don't know you, but they don't actually understand. And so help us to share that good news, Lord. Help us to be a witness to those far from you. And Lord,
I also just lift up the offering that we're about to partake in, that it will be a time of worship, that we can honor you with our first fruits, and that whether we've given already online or we're going to give in the offering plate, help our hearts to be glad in doing so, and help us to be faithful in doing so. And we just thank you for so many that have been faithful to you over the years, and that the giving is there. And Lord, I know as an elder, I think about the building and all these other different things, but I thank you that we don't have to worry, that you will take care of all things. So thank you for taking care of us, and thank you for this new year. In your name, amen.
Glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes. I see this love and mercy washing over all our sin. The people sing. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
I see a generation
rising up to take their place with selfless faith, with selfless faith. I see a near revival stirring as we pray and sing. We're on our knees.
Sing, heal my heart.
Heal my heart and make it clean. Yes, Lord. Open up my eyes to the things unseen. Show me how to love like you have loved me.
Break my heart for what breaks yours.
Break my heart. I am for your kingdom's cause. As I walk from earth into eternity.
Sing Hosanna.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
Sing that again, church.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna,
Hosanna in the highest.
Hosanna in the highest.
One last time.
Hosanna in the highest.
We are born incomplete in so many ways, and I think that's one of the reasons why there is marriage. The guy is thinking right now, yeah, 24/7, she's telling me I'm incomplete. That's not what I had in mind. We are incomplete. That's what God saw, that's what God knew when he made the man, and he said, this is not good. There needs to be a helper suitable. There needs to be like the left hand or the right hand, the two coming together to be one in a way that the man can't be by himself. People did not invent marriage. God did, because he knew our need inside. And there's something inside of all of us, I think, from that point on that says, I have a need. I'm incomplete. Even in terms of a marriage relationship, when the hormones especially, when they start kicking in, you say, I'm incomplete. And there's this longing. Many husbands and wives say today, they've been married for a number of years, they say, I don't feel complete. Not with him, not with her. I got a problem. Over the years, I've seen some marriages that have just been fantastic. In fact, it's those kind of marriages, when I was young, I would look at them and I'd say, that's the kind of marriage I want. That's the kind of family. And even though it wasn't necessarily my family that I could look at, I could see something out there. But I also saw so many, and over the years, over these years of ministry, I have seen so many couples who have learned simply to tolerate each other. They put up with each other. And that's as good as it gets. Others who have learned to need each other desperately, and that's probably the best word to describe their relationship, is desperate. And there are others who have learned very well how to use each other. But they have not learned how to love each other. We are so good at making a mess of life and marriage, all sorts of good things. Today, as we start this series on marriage, I want us to look at myths. Myths that many times we bring into a marriage relationship that add on top of all the regular struggles, more confusion, more hurt, more pain, and often end up shattering marriages. But before we look at those myths, we need to talk about a starting point, a baseline, the foundation. What's essential? What do you think it is? What is essential to make a marriage work? That's a good one. Trust.
Respect.
Good. A lot of people will say, I've heard it many times, what you really need to make a marriage work is love. True love. The starting point for a good marriage, though, is sacrifice. It's sacrifice. Now, you might think, what? You're crazy. Sacrifice, that's the kind of thing you associate with martyrs. That's rare, that's exceptional, you know, that's over-the-top kind of thing. Maybe if you could do that. But you're wrong. The reason I know, I'm convinced, and I see it in God's Word, the reason I'm convinced is because sacrifice is not just the foundation for marriage. It's what God intended for us from the very beginning as the core central characteristic of human nature. It was to be a servant. It was to be more concerned for others. It was to give ourselves. I know that because you look at even the relationship that God intended between us and Him.
We were to give him trust, love, obedience, you know, to give him glory. But the fall turned it all around from giving to taking. I want to take power. I want to take control. I want to take independence. Look at that fruit. I want to take that because it'll make me wise. It'll make me independent. Oh, and it looks so good. It will fill my stomach. And it's just beautiful to look at. I want to take it. See, everything got turned around with the fall. From giving, sacrifice, to taking. And so marriage is just one of the casualties of the change that happened inside of us. That's why sacrifice has to be the essential, the foundation for a marriage if it's going to survive. I look around at marriages. As a pastor, I do marriage counseling, premarital counseling, and I don't know, it's been, what, 30 years, 40 years? I lost track. But I see all the time in marriages, people say, And they're living, I got to have my space, I got to have my things. I ask about finances, they say, I have my bank account, she has her bank account, and we keep them separate, we don't touch. It means they don't really trust each other too. Blended families, she has her kids, I have my kids, we don't interfere with each other. She has her space, I have my space. And that's how they live, and it seems to be okay, at least for a while, until one of them starts taking too much or not giving enough. And if you're called to sacrifice, like, what? Give up my golf game to go pick out new furniture? You got to be kidding. It's because we have come into that marriage expecting to get benefits, to get something. It's why many young guys particularly are thinking about marriage, because they're thinking, man, if I want to live for Jesus, I've got to do something with all these hormones that are driving me. And so, you know, marriage, got to get marriage, and she'll satisfy that for me, right? It's what I can get. That is at the heart of why marriages are coming apart. Because we are playing by the rules of the game of our fall, and not by creation. Taking, not giving. And so what I'm talking about here is not just for those of us who are married. It's for every one of us from our birth. We need to learn what it means to sacrifice, because that was the original design. New life in Jesus begins to reset, to recreate that original design. When God forgives your sin because you have put your trust in Him, He also gives you His Spirit. When you believed in Jesus as the one who died for your sins and rose again, the pilot light is relit. And His Spirit comes to indwell you. And the more that you choose to trust and to obey and to say, He is my Lord, it's like putting fuel on that pilot, and it begins to take control and change your life, change the way you live, the way you think. It's like Paul writes in Ephesians 5:18. He says, as a command, do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. You can see somebody who's under the influence of alcohol. He says, no, you need to be under the influence of the Spirit, and people need to see it in your relationships. Yes, your relationship with God, but it's your relationship with people as well. It needs to change. And it will, as you pour fuel on that pilot light, if you are a believer in Jesus, and you say, He is my Lord, I'm going to follow Him, I'm going to obey Him. And here's what He says in terms of relationships. Here's what flows out of that being filled by the Spirit. Paul writes, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Submit to one another. See, that is not just about marriage. That's about all relationships as believers. Young, old, male, female, to one another. The Spirit resets me back to that original default of sacrifice. Now, many are offended by the word submission, I think, particularly when it's applied in marriage, and you say, well, the wife needs to submit. You talk about it as if it's, you know, kind of a passive, mealy mouse, weak person dominated by the negative self-image kind of thing. Jesus was a servant. That's his number one characteristic. He said, I did not come to be served, but to serve and to give my life a ransom for many. He was the epitome of sacrifice and of submission. And would you say he was weak? Mealy-mouthed? No. He's the King of Kings. Some people think of this idea of submission in, oh, it's giving up control and free will. Yes, it is. Just like Jesus. Not my will, but yours be done, Father. See, that's what it's about. And it is to one another. It's not just for some, it is for all. It is to say, He is my Lord. That's the reverence or the fear of Christ. Not just that He is Lord, He is my Lord. He's the one who calls the shots. He's the one who fills out the page that I've already signed off on. He's the master of today and my relationships. And if this sacrifice, you see, if sacrifice, this whole response to life is not what comes out of you, it's not at the core of your being, when life squeezes you like a sponge, if it's not sacrifice that comes out, then you, honestly, you cannot say, Jesus is my Lord. You could be saved, your sins could be forgiven, He could be the Lord of your life, but you're not letting Him be the Lord of your life. Because if He is, then you'll be like Him, in submission to one another. More concerned for others than for yourself, just like Him, whenever and wherever. It may take different shapes in different relationships. You know, it's certainly easier to do in different places, like here in worship. Oh, be in submission, whether, hey, look, after you. Oh, you want a seat? Here, have a seat. But when you're spending 24/7 with somebody, that's when it starts to fall apart. It's not forced, though. It has to be voluntary, like Jesus. Because of the place that Jesus has in my life, that's why I do it. And it's not about inferior versus superior. It's not about, oh, this is for the follower. You submit, not the leader. I'm not talking to you, leader. Yes, I am. Because which was Jesus, follower or leader? He's the King of Kings. And it's going to be seen in different roles, like I said. Husband, wife, parent, child, employer, employee. But each one is going to be more concerned for the other. It's going to be played out in different roles. So now let's look in the family. What's it look like in a marriage? Wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands as you do to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, His body, of which He is the Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Again, it doesn't mean she's inferior. In fact, Scripture describes the wife as the complement, the partner. But it's just a different role. And it's speaking of how she is to live out her sacrifice in relation to her husband. It's going to take on, in fact, a more significant and important role than to one another, everybody. It's her own husband, a special way. And notice how he says it's as to the Lord. Again, that's the motivation. That comes back to the reason for this. Submit to my husband because I am submitting to the Lord. I submit to my husband in the same way I am submitting to the Lord. It is proof of my relationship to Jesus, my relationship to my husband. It's not because he deserves it. It's not because I'm in the mood. It's because of Jesus. Did you catch that word? For the husband is head of the wife. And some people just want to camp there on this idea of headship, idea of authority. But did you notice how it defines that? The husband is the head of the wife as Christ is head of the church, His body, of which He is the Savior. It doesn't say, of which He is the commander, of which He is the ruler, the decision maker, the boss. It says, of which He is the Savior. That defines headship. What does it mean to be the head? It means to be the point, the first one to sacrifice. The Savior. That is how a husband is to love his wife, to be the first. Headship is for the benefit of the wife. It is not for the benefit of the husband so that he can call the shots, so he can be the boss, so he can be, looked up to. In fact, when Paul speaks to the husband, he doesn't even use the word head. It's not something husbands need to focus on because we tend to get it wrong. We tend to abuse it. And so, when it comes to husbands, this is what Scripture says. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave Himself up for her, to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the Word, and to present her to Himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. The husband, sacrifice. I mean, you would think since the wives were told to submit, you'd have something here about, and husbands are supposed to rule well. It doesn't say that. There's only one command. In fact, it's a word repeated 6 times here, and that is love. How? Love. What do you do? As Christ, who gave Himself, there it is again, gave Himself for the church. The responsibility in the marriage, men, it lies with the husband, not with the wife. And that doesn't mean to make the decisions and be the boss. See, you cannot push off on her the blame by saying, if there's a lack of love, it's coming from her. She's giving me the cold shoulder all the time. If there is a problem of intimacy, it's because she won't open up. If there is a problem of harmony, it's just because she doesn't agree with how we're to do things here. Husbands, you cannot blame her for not taking the lead because she wasn't supposed to. You are. And it's a lead of sacrifice. It's a lead that says, I will set the standard for what it means to be more concerned for the other person than for myself. Just like Jesus did, and because He's my Lord. The wife then responds in a way, if she is filled with the Spirit, in a way that shows that same kind of care. I'm more concerned for you than for myself. See, from the fall, we have a nature that's all twisted around. It's about taking. We demand, we blame, we control, we say, what do I get out of this? Jesus resets it back to creation. He says, give up the self-centeredness. It's about giving, not taking. That's how I made you. So husbands, you say, how should I love my wife? The answer is simple. Like Jesus loves you. Sacrifice. He gave Himself, and no one forced Him. And He loved you first. See, the goal described here is Jesus is at work in us to make us a thing of beauty, radiant, spotless, without blemish before God. He wants to present us that way to the Father. And husbands, that's the same goal you have for your wife. To give in such a way, so sacrificially, that she will be, she will grow, she will develop into all that God intended her to be in creation. What about the myths? First myth. We expect the same things. Two people come together, they say, yeah, we pretty much expect the same things. But that's not possible. Husbands and wives come together with conscious and unconscious expectations that aren't always fulfilled, and it creates problems. You say, but we value the same things. We love doing the same things together. Hey, been there, done that, folks. I know. So you say, oh, we both love music. Oh, we love the movies, you know. In fact, one of our first dates was to see 101 Dalmatians. Ooh, wasn't that romantic? Anyway, so I had this expectation of sharing these things together. Problem is, I really get into music. She likes it playing in the background. And movies, I like, you know, things that challenge, that are kind of intense and pull me in. That's too intense. She likes a short, sweet story, romantic, you know, kind of thing. Maybe one of you is clean and the other is cluttered. Yeah, you're right. Maybe one of you is fun and spontaneous and socializing. The other one says, no, we got to get our chores done, daily routines, you know, check off this, and then we'll have some quiet time. You come together, you assume that you'll easily adjust, you'll learn to enjoy each other and each other's things, and that she will stop doing the things that irritate me and start giving me what I want. But it doesn't work that way. Unspoken rules. We have all sorts of unspoken rules. Neve and I hit this one real early. As I was getting to know her and her family, in fact, I was invited over for a family occasion. And her family is not Italian, but it could be. The way they talk, hands and voices raised and everything like that. And if you, in their family rules, if you want to play the game, you got to kind of push your way in. And I came up from a family where you just wait your turn. And when there's a break, you can speak. So this went on, this particular occasion, and I got in the car afterward, and I was driving her back to her house, and she said, what's wrong with you? I said, what do you mean, what's wrong with me? She said, well, my uncle said that you're a very proud person, and you don't engage with us. In fact, seem very critical of us because you just sit there quietly. And I said, I sat there quietly because I was waiting for a chance to say something and you guys never gave it to me. We had our own sets of rules that had never been spoken. And you come together, you discover something like that. See, you don't always expect the same things. In fact, you start to discover the more that you spend time together and that there are many things that you don't see the same way. You have ideas of what's acceptable and what isn't. Things like don't interrupt another's words, don't ask for help unless you are desperate, downplay your successes, don't talk about money in public, don't volunteer to help, never raise your voice, don't show up late, make your bed when you get up, clean the kitchen before you go to bed, don't buy expensive gifts, and you don't agree. So how do you handle expectations? Well, it really isn't that difficult, though it is hard. You'll see what I mean. Here's what you got to do. You got to talk about them. Sometimes that's the stumbling point. But you got to lay them out. You got to say, what is it that's driving this? What's my expectation on this? Maybe make a list, both of you. And then you look at that list, because you cannot have everything on the list, both of you. You're going to have to decide which few things really are essential, crucial things that we must expect together. And then you sacrifice whatever is needed in order to keep those things. But the whole rest of the list, and it'll be a long one, you say, I don't really need to die for that one. So what do? What's our key word? Sacrifice it. I'm willing to let it go because I'm more concerned for you than for me. What makes me comfortable, what I'm used to. So by the way, an example of that. I still wait for my turn sometimes. But Neva in conversations will create a space for me. And I've learned enough to know when she's created that space. Because people are listening for her to say something because she's on a roll, and all of a sudden she stops and she turns and looks at me. Oh, my turn. It's almost enjoyable how we do this. Almost. Then there are also unconscious roles that we have. Unconscious roles that come from our personalities, our family backgrounds, our expectations. Choosing color. Whose job is that when you're painting the room? You're both kind of, what color do you like? I don't know. What color do you like? I don't know. And you're back and forth. You're waiting for somebody to take the lead on that. That's played out in all sorts of common roles that you have. Who's the planner? Who's the navigator? The shopper? The secret keeper? The cook? The comedian? The gift buyer? The cleaner? The keeper of the finances? The disciplinarian? And you will find, in fact, I encourage you to look at who has strengths in a particular area. Neva's colorblind, so I'm the color chooser. If the guy cannot balance a checkbook, then don't put him in charge of the finances, even though I'm the man and I have to do it. No, you don't. And she doesn't have to do the cook if he can cook a whole lot better, you know? What you do, list them out and sacrifice. More concern for the other than for yourself. Well, that's the first myth, that we expect the same things. No, you don't. You have to sacrifice in the same way. Secondly, the good will get better. Many things do improve, but some things get harder. Every successful marriage requires necessary losses, sacrifices. You give up childhood because you're coming into a marriage. You can't let your parents rule anymore. You give up regular hangouts, at least some of them, and maybe some friends that you've had. She maybe wonders even after the first week, who is this man who took me away from my family? Maybe you give up a carefree lifestyle. There's all sorts of unexpected inconveniences that come in that you hadn't even thought of. A big one, probably one of the biggest, is you have to give up an idealized image of your partner. Reality is going to set in. You might think, oh, he's Mr. Wonderful. Oh, she's the beauty. And then all of a sudden, you hear noises that shouldn't come from a beauty. You smell things that shouldn't come from a handsome guy. First night of our marriage, Neva was sound asleep, and it was the middle of the night, and it was all dark in the room, and she didn't know I'd gotten up out of bed. But she hears a noise, a clicking sound. Bill, do you hear that? From across the room. What? Bill, where are you? Why aren't you in bed here? He said, I had to go to the bathroom. So she said, well, what's that noise? And I had to explain to her, when I was in high school, my best friend was blind from birth, and he taught me to snap my fingers and listen to the echo, and I could navigate around in dark rooms. And so I just did it out of habit. And she thought, you're insane. Who have I married? What do you do in a relationship when you have these kind of differences? Well, what you tend to do is to put on a mask. You pretend that you're something that you want to be or they want you to be. That only works for so long, because after a while it gets so hard to keep up the mask. And that's why many marriages end with the decree, incompatibility, which simply means I couldn't keep wearing the mask. What do you do with these differences? Our word? Sacrifice. You're going to have to adjust. And in the sacrifice, what I mean by this is you are more concerned for the needs of the other than for yourself. You're willing to let go of some things. If it means no longer snap your fingers, okay, I'll do that. But more importantly, seriously, it's starting to appreciate the special gifts that God has given you in that other person that were always there and didn't need to be covered with a mask. I know sometimes in a marriage you say, but we've lost the romance. And by romance, you even mean specifically in terms of those very special times that you have together physically. Friends, start to appreciate the fleeting moments of romance for what they really are. Very special experiences. Something very special, and very special, you don't need to have at every meal. You know what I'm saying? Disenchantment enables you to move to a deeper intimacy where it doesn't have to be about bodies, but about souls, about the person. If you're willing to let go and to give yourself, think back for a moment to the first man and woman, Adam and Eve. Think about that for a moment. Eve, imagine her going out into the fields looking for food. She has in her mind a mental picture of what she hopes to find. She's going out looking in the fields and she can't find it. But she sees, oh, here is a very good fruit. Something special God has made. She has a decision at this point. She can either say, oh, this is wonderful. I don't need what I was thinking. This is great. Or she can say, it's not what I was thinking of, and turn that into spoiled fruit. To say, no, I'm still looking for this. And maybe she'll never find it. When that was as much a good gift as even the thing that she's imagined that could be out there somewhere. It's a decision of letting go, of saying, it's not about me getting, but about me giving. Yes, the good will get better, some of it. And the things that are bad, it's still good, because there is a gift there that God has given me. Third myth, the bad will disappear. Some of you laughing already. The bad will disappear. Fall in love, live happily ever after. The truth is, many people marry in order to avoid or escape unpleasantness. There's something wrong in their lives that they're trying to get away from. Marriage does not erase personal pain or eliminate loneliness. The reason is, see, the problem here is, you're coming there hoping that the other person and the marriage is going to fix what's wrong in you. But you see, the problem is they're coming also with trying to get a fix out of marriage and from you. And both of you are wanting to take, neither is wanting to give, and you end up with greater frustration multiplied together than you even had before the marriage in that personal pain or loneliness. We all suffer from feelings of self-doubt, unworthiness, and inadequacy. But we look to our spouse to convince us that we are, after all, worthwhile and that they can heal our pain. Marriage can be a powerful healing agent over time, but only if each of us is willing to give up the right to have and sacrifice instead. To be vulnerable. To be more concerned about helping than being helped. And to allow our spouse to love us and to learn how to love them. The last myth. He, she will make me whole. Now opposites do attract. I'm amazed sometimes when I see two people just really make a success out of marriage. And I thought beforehand, man, they are the most unlikely couple I have ever seen. But it's true, you complement each other. But I've also said, it's like porcupines learning to hug each other. It's going to be painful. You've got to learn to shift around. Marriage challenges us to new heights. It calls us to be the best person possible. But those demands and our partner will not magically make us whole. Many times people start with the belief to be successful means that we were meant to be, that we were made for each other. And then a few years down the road, they say, man, if only I had chosen Mr. Right, if only I had found Miss Right, you know. This whole myth that we have to be made for each other, which means that this other person is wrong because they are not giving me what I think I need. See how that taking mentality changes everything, ruins it. An attitude that makes you dependent on the other person in an unhealthy way, a selfish way, because you're not giving me what I need to make me whole. It's depending on them for a continual support, an assurance, and a wholeness. You end up then with maybe a low self-esteem, a sense of inferiority. You're easily controlled by your partner, and the other one exerts that control because what they want is control. Each one desperately trying to grab what they think they need and not giving, sacrificing. The opposite can be just as bad. A disengaged couple. Two people in the same house, but they are isolated, they are alone, they are independent, they need nobody. A healthy relationship instead is interdependent, like God intended. A helper suitable. Each more concerned for the other. Each giving sacrifice. What you discover over time, friends, what you will discover over time is a joy and a fulfillment that comes from giving yourself. And maybe you're thinking right now, no, that won't come. That just means I'll be a doormat. I'll be stomped on, wiped on. That is not going to work. It's going to be demeaning. It's going to be draining. And it's not. But I can tell you, and others as well, who have been giving themselves for years, for decades, 40 years, 50 years, 60 years in the marriage, and they will say, if it's a strong, healthy, successful marriage, they will say, I feel more fulfilled than I have ever felt before. You know why? It's not because the other person is giving them what they need. It's because they are doing what they were made for, giving themselves. More concern for the other person than for themselves. God made you, the human being, from the beginning for sacrifice, to give of yourself to Him, to give of yourself to somebody else. And as it happens together, both of you discover a completeness that God intended from creation. If you are not a believer in Jesus, maybe you're asking the question, can I have a better marriage if I learn to sacrifice? And the answer is, yes, you can. You can, because you will be doing the things that God made us to do. The problem with that is that you will not be yet. You will not be the person God made us yet to be. There is still a part of you that will still be incomplete in your life, in your soul, that will not be reset back to creation yet. And it is not something you can do. Only God can do it. And God has already made it possible by Jesus, who died in your place to pay for your sins so that you could be forgiven and then have new life by His Spirit who indwells you, that as it were resets you back to the default position of creation, but now as a new creation. It's available today. We're going to close soon. We're going to have some time remembering Jesus' sacrifice for us. See, He's already made the way through a sacrifice of His Son. There it comes back again, the one who gave Himself for you. Back in this corner, after our time of worship, there'll be some people who have lanyards, badges like this,
wearing them, the Forcey prayer, our Sunday prayer team, if you would like somebody to pray for you and the emptiness inside, or for your marriage, or for your relationship with God or relationship with somebody else, look for somebody back in that corner wearing this. They're there to pray for you. God has so much more for your life, whether you're single or married, for your marriage, than I think we have yet discovered. And all it needs to begin that process, that journey, is to say, I need Jesus as my Lord, and to sacrifice like He did. Father, You have shown us what sacrifice means. You have loved us, shown us love. You loved us first. I pray for marriages and for families that they will discover, first through a relationship with You through Jesus, and secondly, by making Jesus their Lord, that they will learn what it means to be more concerned for others than for themselves, and to know the joy, the fulfillment that comes from sacrifice. In Jesus' name.
Draw near and bless Your name.
Just think about all the things that Jesus had to give up and all the ways that he sacrificed for you. But God demonstrated his love toward us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Let's eat together.
Wonderful cross.
Jesus said the next time that he drinks his cup with his followers is together in his Father's kingdom. He is the King of kings and Lord of lords. So what did it cost him to sacrifice everything for us? See, that's what it means to be the head. And it's to Jesus, our Lord, my Lord, that I remember the cost of his sacrifice. And together, let's drink.
and I hear the Savior say,
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child, the weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. 'Cause Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left the crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
Lord, now indeed I find thy power and thine alone. Yes, Lord, can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. 'Cause Jesus paid it all.
Everything.
Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
And went before the throne.
And went before the throne. I stand. Jesus died my soul to save. My lips shall still ring.
Jesus,
'cause Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white.
Jesus paid it all.
Jesus paid it all through him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white.
Sin had left.
Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow.
And oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt. Jesus paid it all.
And Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
Sin had left.
Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow.
So the test is going to begin or continue this afternoon, this week. There are going to be all sorts of things that want to shatter your relationship and pull you apart. For some of you, it already started before you left home this morning. Remember, Jesus is your Lord. And remember, stop and think, how much did He sacrifice for me? And because He's my Lord, I will choose to sacrifice for her, for Him. Because in the end, you could let go of everything except for Him and except for her or Him. Go in His grace and His power, because He gives hope. Thank you. Yeah.